Many of the greatest battles for freedom and human rights have been fought not on the battlefield, but in the courtroom. These conflicts often involve taking a stand for what one believes in, and resisting laws or accusations that strip one of his or her inherent rights as an American. In a time of unprecedented tension between the values of old and new, the Roaring Twenties brought forth what is commonly agreed to be the trial of the century, the Scopes Monkey Trial. The advent of the 1920s saw the rise of fundamentalism as a reaction to the more secular tendencies of religion during the Gilded Age and into the 20th century. Many people reverted back to the primordial, fundamental values upon which their religion was based. This conservative movement would accept nothing but an absolutely literal interpretation of the Bible, ignoring any facts that might debase what they perceived as the truth. Another entirely different movement was gaining strength in this time period as well. Evolutionism. Begun in 1859 when Charles Darwin published the simultaneously acclaimed and reviled On the Origin of the Species, evolutionism continued to grow in scientific circles throughout the remainder of the century. As the 20th century dawned, new discoveries were made that substantiated Darwin's theories. Due in large part to this turn of events, two movements which had formerly been at peace, at least on the surface, were now at war. As far as the fundamentalists were concerned, since evolution was not written in the Bible, it was impossible for it to be true. Instead of merely seeing it as false, however, the fundamentalists decided to interpret evolution as a direct and vicious attack on everything they believed to be true. Evolutionists, on the other hand, could not understand how fundamentalists could blatantly disregard all reason by choosing to believe that that which was written to prove a point or teach a lesson was instead a historical truth. This abject lack of understanding between the two sides fueled not only words, but actions as well. The southern states, specifically the Bible Belt, were ardent fundamentalists, and as such, they saw it as their duty to rid the world of blasphemies like tirelessly to extract the teaching of evolution from public school classrooms. One such instance of legislation was Tennessee's Butler Act, the statute upon which the Scopes trial rested. The law stated plainly that it shall be unlawful for any teacher in any of the universities, normals, and all other public schools of the state, which are supported in whole or in part by the public school funds of the state, to teach any theory that denies the story of the divine creation of man as taught in the Bible, and to teach instead that man has descended from a lower order of animals.
The American Civil Liberties Union, founded earlier in the same decade, strongly opposed the Butler Act, believing it to be an infringement of First Amendment rights. The chairperson of the ACLU, Charles Skinner, published an ad stating that his organization was looking for a Tennessee teacher who was willing to accept their services in testing this law in the courts. It was not at first Scopes who answered the call, but George Rapalier, a Dayton citizen and member of the Five Points Methodist Church in the town. Rapalier, supported by Fred E. Robinson, chairman of the county school board, approached Scopes about accepting the ACLU's ad. Scopes accepted the offer to test the authority of the law and was arrested. By teaching the theory of evolution in an effort to test the authority of the Butler Act, John T. Scopes took a stand against the blatantly pro-fundamentalist law, and in doing so, provided a platform for an epic clash between two opposing titans, creationism and evolutionism. A town that H.L. Mencken described as full of charm and even some beauty, Dayton, Tennessee became the very eye of the media storm that was to ensue during the trial. In a few short days, the streets of Dayton were filled with businessmen, preachers, refreshment stands, telegraphers, and over 100 newspaper reporters from all over the country. The atmosphere of the town during the trial was often described as circus-like, or, as Mencken put it, farcical in all its details. This view derived from the trial's role as an attraction meant to put Dayton on the map, as well as an image aptly portrayed in a famous editorial cartoon by Edmund Duffy. After the arrest and trial were announced, attorneys were needed for both prosecution and defense, though Arthur Garfield Hayes, Dudley Field Malone, and John R. Neal were already part of the defense team. Clarence Darrow, an agnostic, volunteered his services on the side of Scopes. Darrow was a man of science, believing firmly that it could beat fundamentalism. Many agree that Darrow was always able to link his cases to underlying philosophies and social truths taking place at the time. So was the case with the Scopes trial. For the prosecution, three-time presidential candidate William Jennings Bryan aided attorneys Ben McKenzie and A. Thomas Stewart. Bryan, who was then a prominent fundamentalist spokesperson, described evolutionism as the most paralyzing influence with which civilization has had to contend during the last century. drunk on religious excitement, the so-called Trial of the Century began in Dayton on the unassuming date of July 10, 1925. From the very first day of the trial, the jury selection process, there was an obvious air of quintessential disagreement. Clarence Darrow interviewed a possible juror, but the prosecution attorney objected to Darrow's questions. In the end, Darrow rejected the juror on the grounds of potential bias. Later that day, the prosecution rejected another juror.
The trial went on for the next 8 days, and not a single one lacked controversy. In addition to the overall dispute between creationism and evolutionism, there were other debates, ranging from the constitutionality of the Butler Act, to a debate over prayer, to an argument over whether experts should be allowed to testify in the trial. None of these disputes, however, came even remotely close to the tension present in the climax of the trial, the day Brian took the witness stand. On this day, the seventh day of the trial, Darrow called Brian to the witness stand to interrogate him on his literal interpretation of the Bible. In the Bible, it is said that God created the world and all things in it during the first 6 days of creation, and then rested on the seventh. If, before the day Darrow questioned Brian had ever considered himself to be in any way like God, his thoughts were crushed that day, for, unlike God, Brian did not rest on the seventh day. He fought for all he believed in. It was a particularly hot day in July, and, due to worries that the number of people present in the courthouse might cause the floor to collapse, the trial was moved outside. Once Brian had taken the witness stand, Darrow proceeded to question him on various stories in the Bible that any man of science would immediately consider wholly unfounded, but that fundamentalists accepted as fact.
Your Honor, I think I can shorten this testimony. The only purpose Mr. Darrow has is to slander the Bible, but I will answer his question, and I have no objection in the world. I want the world to know that this man, who does not believe in a God, is trying to use a court in Tennessee to slur at it, and while it will require time, I am willing to take it.
I object to your statement. I'm exempting you on your fool ideas that no intelligent Christian on earth believes. On the eighth and final day of the trial, the jury read the verdict, proclaiming John T. Scopes guilty of violating the Butler Act by teaching evolution in his biology classroom. The judge sentenced him to a $100 fine, the lowest allowed by law. This verdict, though, was expected by all, including the defense, because whether Scopes was guilty or innocent was not what was on trial. Instead, science and religion were on trial. This concluded the famous Scopes Monkey Trial. This was not, however, the end of the issues at the heart of the trial, creationism versus evolutionism. The debate had several direct repercussions, and continues to rage on even today. The Scopes trial's inevitable verdict was a symbol of the fundamentalists' current legislative power in the South, but the trial's lasting effects left fundamentalists politically weary. The trial quickly became a mockery of fundamentalists, giving modernists the public edge despite the traditionalist judicial victory. Unfortunately for anti-fundamentalists, the trial's public exposure had little immediate effect on the changing of laws.
The heated dispute within the trial, as well as the outcome, established precedent for conflict between fundamentalism and evolutionism that would continue throughout the century and into contemporary debates. Today, the ideas of creationism still exist in the form of intelligent design. It has been described as a way to give creationism an air of scientific authority and cast it as scientific theory. The idea of intelligent design mainly centers on the likelihood of an intelligent, benevolent cause behind the creation of the universe rather than natural selection. Evolutionism, on the other hand, has become even more widely accepted than it was at the time of the Scopes trial, and is regarded by many in the scientific fields as fact rather than simply a theory. The Scopes monkey trial, despite the time that has passed since its conclusion, has remained one of the most discussed and debated trials in American history. This is due in large part to the courage of John T. Scopes. Scopes, in coalition with the American Civil Liberties Union, took a stand against the fundamentalist restriction of First Amendment rights, specifically in the form of the Butler Act. In testing the Butler Act, Scopes and the ACLU were taking a stand not only against the teachings of creationism as fact, but against the general traditionalist sentiment at the time, which sought to draw America away from more modern ideas. This trial remains a shining example of someone standing up for what he believes in, despite what forces may try to oppose him.
Soon you'll be drenched to the bone if your time to you is worth saving. Then you better start swimming or you'll sink like a stone, for the times they are a-changing. Come writers and critics and prophesize with your pen. Keep your eyes open, the chance won't come again.
and watch what you say, for the wheel's still in spin. There's no telling who that it's an alien.